What you mean?
There it is.
Why do you talk like that?
Why are you dressing like that?
Why does your face look like that?
Why do you have this room talking to me?
Good morning. Are you sad? Okay, look at these cats. No, make you happy.
I don't care.
Cats. Don't you like cats?
No.
Cats. How do you feel about these cats? Aren't they warm and fuzzy? Don't you love cats? Yeah. Cat, meow.
Pretty. They're gorgeous.
Your mom told me that you stole her earrings.
No, I didn't. She misplaced them.
You know, it's okay to tell me the truth.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How you doing today?
I feel kind of sad.
Whoa, sad? That's not normal. You know what? Nothing more about it. You want to describe your situation in the event of antidepressants?
Isn't that a bit rough? Okay.
Yes.
Well, that's new. Where'd you get it?
How are you?
I'm fine.
So you ready to begin?
I have this method that I would like to try. Just you look at these cats and tell me how to fight.
Well, you know, I'm not on any time. I just want to know what happened.
Oh, well, I'm here to help. Don't worry.
Thank you. Thank you.
How are you today?
Good morning,
everyone.
Good morning.
And for some of you that we haven't seen this year, Happy New Year 2016, Sweet 16. We'd like to welcome you to Culture Cafe today. On behalf of the Network 180, the Community Family Partnership, and our Cultural and Linguistic Work Group, the CLR Group, we would like to welcome you. Today, our presenter speaks for himself. Just his name speaks alone. Jerry Johnson. And if you have your folder, there is a wonderful, some information about the presenter that's inside, so I don't need to go over that at all. Take a moment just to look at that. And we just wanted to say that we are really pleased to have him back. This is not Mr. Johnson's first time with us at our Cultural Cafe. So we want you to get an opportunity to be involved and not only just to sit and listen, but to participate as we look under the magnifying glass at a closer look at our own cultural biases. I brought my magnifying glass. I don't know. Do you have your magnifying glass? Don't answer that question. So I just wanted to go over and give you just a couple of housekeeping tips. And first of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Dawana Lancaster, and I'm one of the CLR work group members, and I am also the services coordinator for Community Family Partnership. And while I'm saying that, can we have the rest of our CLR work group members please stand so that we can see you? All right, or wave your hand. Great. So thank you for being here this morning. And our CFP team, would you please stand? All right, and then we have some of our Community Family Partnership team members that are outside working with registrations. Our project director is Terry Clark, and she was not able to be here today, but she brings you greetings as well. So I just wanted to go over just a couple housekeeping tips. We're going to begin in a couple minutes, but hopefully everyone has registered, signed in, and put your name and if you registered, as well as you're able to get CEU credits as well. So please make sure you sign in, and then when we leave this presentation and go over to for lunch and our roundtable discussions, make sure you sign out when you leave here. We'll take the paper over to the gym as well, and sign back in when we go to our roundtable discussions, okay? So we'll give you more directions. Please feel free to have some water if you need water or some coffee. We have some of that in the entrance. The restrooms are located right outside the door as you go to your right. If you go out, please come back, return, so we can be able to finish up the presentation. And without further ado, we are going to have our presenter, Mr. Jerry Johnson, come forward. Let's give him a hand.
Greetings. So I'm told that I have to do this.
Please.
Not that you can't hear me, but they're recording me. It's a little scary because that means I might have to clean it up. I'm thrilled to be here today. This is a very serious, sensitive subject. We're going to take a peek at the concept of racial equity. I'm going to show you the beginning of this presentation. There'll be some data from across Grand Rapids and Kent County, doing some comparisons in a way that many of you may not have seen them before. We're going to then spend, after we discuss all of this, we'll spend the rest of the workshop looking at some of the systemic, systems-level issues that get in the way of the work that we're all trying to do. I think one of the problems that we have historically when we do training, and I'm guilty as a member of one of the schools of social work, in all schools we do it about the same, but we do this across the board, and that is that we disconnect what we're doing on the ground from what's going on somewhere else. So we end up running our heads against the brick wall over and over and over and over again, taking solace in that one case that turns out to be really well, or those two cases that make some improvement. But when we start looking at numbers across the board, we realize that we're not making any progress. Citywide, region-wide, county-wide. As I'm at Grand Valley now. For the last 3 years prior to this fall semester, I was the direct. Is this not working? Can I just set that on the table? So I'm going to bang it around. This recording is going to be great. So, what was I saying? I'm at Grand Valley right now in the School of Social Work, and I have been since 1995 or 96. But the last 3 years, I was the director of the Community Research Institute and the Kellogg Foundation portfolio evaluator for Kent County, for all of their investments in Kent County. And I did that for 5 years. And one of the things that we began looking at when I was in the Kellogg Foundation was area-wide needles. Everybody's heard the phrase, we want to make the needle move. We want to make the needle move, right? So that's beyond just what few cases go on here and there, but we're trying to actually affect area numbers. But we're going to look at area numbers today. And I want to see where we're at. These are the latest numbers across the board, and I'll get there in a second. The other thing I have to say is, having been in this community since 1987, and I do have to point out that this woman right here, Babe Taz, worked with me at Project Rehab with me. She was here the first day I arrived in Grand Rapids. You know, a yellow sports car, and long hair, and that was a different Grand Rapids back then, for those of you that are old enough to remember. So, anyways, I've been involved, like many of you have, in working against racism and discrimination at all levels for many, many years. When we get into this later, when we first started looking at diversity and thought of the magic of how diversity and diversifying our staffs and our boards will somehow magically change the world, I was a part of all of that. Well, I have to give credit to the Kellogg Foundation, because what they've done in the last 5 years is they've introduced a whole new lexicon as it relates to racism and anti-racism work, and that's racial equity. This wasn't heard of until they began spreading this around. And racial equity is what we're going to focus on, because that's really becomes the issue for all of us, and that is, right now, I want you to get this definition. A state of racial equity will exist when a person's racial or ethnic identity at birth does not statistically dictate their life outcome. In this particular day and age, where we stand right now, if you look at the stats, and we're going to look at them right now, there's always exceptions, but right now, a person's racial and ethnic identity at birth dictates their chances in life across the board. So what the effort has to be is trying to figure out, both on the ground at the micro level and at the systemic level, what are those things that just didn't start happening in the last 20 years. This just didn't start happening with the recession. This has been going on for decades. Some of it's getting worse. The recession was a big part of that when it gets into economics, which we'll show in a second. But we have to start thinking about not just how can we be culturally competent in our offices,
But how can we also simultaneously begin figuring out how we can improve conditions that allow equity to exist, both in the work that we do with our clients, at the agency level, and how we run ourselves, and at the policy level. Now, what I don't want to do is just say, this stuff's all baked in Lansing and there's nothing we can do about it, so let's just all have a drink and move on. That's not what I'm talking about here. But what we know from history is, if we stand around and wait for people in Lansing to get it before anything changes, then we're going to be here another 30, 40 years from now. Hopefully I'm still here. They'll wheel me out for that workshop, talking about the same things, watching this data stay, these gaps stay essentially the same. Okay? So racial equity. This is important to get. Right now, today, in Grand Rapids, the best place to raise a family, I'm going to show you the data and how they came to that, and show you the actual data for people that aren't in the age group that fit that. We are the best place to raise a family if you're me, or some of us in this room. If you're some of the others in this room, we're really not very good at all. And I'll show you how they manage, how that gets covered over when we present data, okay? Racial equity. So what we're really looking at when it turns to the study of racial equity, what we really need to begin identifying, putting out there, leaving out for people to see is racial disparities. What are the disparities on outcomes from income, education, health, across the board, between Caucasians and African Americans, or Caucasians and Hispanics, and I would like to do, and Latinos, but I'd like to do others, but the data is not, the sample sizes aren't big enough to be able to do that. So we're going to stay with those three. So what goes on, and what I've learned is, I've been making these kinds of presentations for a long, long time. And when I stand up here and I just say, or any of us say, yeah, there's a big education gap, big reading gap between white and black in Grand Rapids, everybody nods their head. What we never do is actually show it. So the data that I'm going to show you today is presented a little bit different. We're going to show the standard bar charts. We'll show the bar charts on the right. I'll come back to this. On the left. And then on the right, what I've done is we've taken the data and we've calculated the disparity gap between whites and blacks and whites and Latinos. And for each one of these, we'll be able to see exactly what the gap is. Current data, I get this recharged every time a new data source comes out. So we'll get there in just a second. Now, I've had people high up in places tell me that we shouldn't do this. We're just making people angry. And my response to that is, what you hiding? What you hiding? If we don't know the state of affairs, we can't fix it. Right? If we don't know where things stand, then we're doing what we've been doing for the last 30 or 40 years, which is trying to find a magic bullet that'll make it. Right? And I'll get into that later on. So I used to do the data after the other part of the presentation, but I'm going to do it first because it's a little bit stunning. What I've learned is that even when I do this presentation with this data, to people that have been specifically working in the anti-racism movement over the last 20 years, they sit and look at some of these gaps when it's made that concrete and go, holy manure. I got to remember, I'm in the chapel. Those of you that know me, this isn't my, always been my home turf. So, I am a Flint boy, and I'm going to avoid talking about, well, an example of what I'm talking about is the water problem in Flint.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if any of you are, how many do we know here know that area of the state? You know where Grand Blanc is? How long would this have happened if this was Grand Blanc water? First brown drip that came out of a faucet, and they'd have torn all the pipes up and fixed it. Right? They'd have trucked in water from the North Atlantic if they had to make sure that this didn't happen. So that's another whole thing. But it's an example of, I think, of when we get into the second half of this, of what we're talking about. Now, I know many of you, you know I talk fast, I'm moving. If you got a comment or question, just flag it down. Don't wait. There's no formal sort of moment to ask questions. We'll stop and we'll talk about what you're interested in. I'm going to make, this is a systemic presentation, but we're going to bring it to the ground after I get done with the debate. Right? We'll have that opportunity for those that are practitioners to talk about some of that stuff. And I've even got some of your data, CFP's data. I looked at it last night. There might be a couple of places in the data that you're finding where some of what we're going to talk about today might apply. You follow? Just in your data numbers. Any questions before I get moving? Now, here's the question as it comes to data that we never ask. When you're sitting in meetings and we talk about how successful our work is, or if you're a social worker and you're learning a new model, we hear about CBT and somebody does, this model works. What we never ask the question is, this model works for whom? When we say something works, or a program works, even if the data shows it, in most of our programs, the majority of people are white folks. Right? Most programs. We never ask the question for whom, as it relates to success, life outcomes, or progress. What I want you, if you walk away from here with nothing else today, if you only get one thing, next time you're sitting in a meeting, and somebody comes into the room and says, hey, we're going to do this because it works, I want you to look at this, them and say, for whom does it work for? In my role with Kellogg and at CRI, there are agencies in town, you guys don't happen to be one of them, but there are agencies in town that don't even record race and ethnic data. So when we get data, we're looking at aggregate data. We're looking at for everybody. This is how Grand Rapids became the best place to raise a family. And I'll show you that in a minute. Because nobody asked the question, it's the best place to raise a family for whom? And when you break that down and go through the extra steps, you learn a different story. Tale of two, tale of three. Probably if we had data at the level for other groups of color, you'd find out that we might have a tale of six or seven cities here. Right? So for whom? Remember, that's going to be your mantra from now on. I hate this thing, by the way. For whom? I just have to tell you how I'm feeling. You guys will like it. So we're going to look at some data. And I picked out 15, 20 slides of the big things, because I could go on and on and on forever. But they fall in these basic categories. So we're going to look at some of the most current data that I can get my hands on, disaggregated by race and ethnicity, and then compared and see how folks are doing. First is economics. This was a big part of the report that said Grand Rapids is the best place to raise a family. Grand Rapids unemployment by race. This is the city of Grand Rapids. What is our overall unemployment rate in Grand Rapids right now? I just heard it on the news the other night. They were throwing some party. In the city of Grand Rapids, it's about 6-7%, right? City of Grand Rapids. Look at the racial disparity between white and black on the right. If there's a parenthesis around it, that means that it's not good in general. African-American unemployment in the city of Grand Rapids is 28%. Latino is 12.5%, and white unemployment is 5.7%. So when we say Grand Rapids is an economic miracle after the recession, and we ask the question, or you ask the question, for whom? Who is it a miracle for? Me. Thank you. Unemployment. 2 years before this, it was 29%. So I guess we could say we're making some progress. And I do have another slide that I don't have here today where I broke this one by gender. African-American women unemployment is 27%. African-American male unemployment is 29%. So it's not much better by gender. Household median income. This is where aggregation makes any community look great. If you look to the right bar chart, I think I actually have a pointer on this. If you look there, that's the number that the report stated that said Grand Rapids was the best place to raise a family. 44,531. Look at the comparison between black and white. Blacks have, on average, $22,000 a year less median income than whites. Hispanics is $13,000, or Latinos is $13,000. So one of the big categories we talk about is home ownership, home affordability. Right? Everything's affordable. Well, it is probably if your income's $45,000 a year. Things become different if the median income for a group is $22,000 a year. We did some little calculations on that median income. Average rents around here are about $750 a month. And that's not getting something that's very good. That's a one bedroom, right? You throw in utilities and food, now you're talking about $1,200, $1,300 a month just to eat, not freeze, right? And have a roof over your head. This is before anything else. What's $1,200 a month times 12? That's $14,000 a year, right? No, 12. $14,000, $15,000 a year just to pay your bills. What's the status for living expenses to income to rent is 30%? It's everybody who's got that income right there, or that those two incomes right there are vulnerable. This is household median. Oh, I'm sorry. This is 2012. Let me show you the latest numbers. Watch the bottom two numbers. That's 12. There's 13. That's the latest number. Did you see them go up? The gap has widened in the last year. The recession ended in 2010. You follow me? 22,000 is the gap, 13,000 is the gap. It dropped by $2,000 over the last year data. And I just got these numbers given to me about a month ago. So these are as hot as you can find them. Everything lags behind. So with all this stuff going on, if we don't ask the question for whom, people of color, at least African Americans and Latinos, are falling behind in a time when we're supposed to be doing really, really well. On average. And if we don't ask that number, we get stuck with this one. And look at Grand Rapids for African Americans and Latinos lags behind every other area. It lags behind the state and the country pretty significantly. We're worse, our gaps are worse than anywhere else on average here in Grand Rapids. Now, I'm not trying to say Grand Rapids isn't a great place to be. I think we could go to almost any community and find some of the same things. They might not be as drastic. That's not at all what I'm saying. What I am saying, though, is that like any place else, if you like a place enough, you should be willing to know the truth so that you can dig in and try to fix it. Just because it's this way, historically, we've sort of said, well, what's our interpretation? People, I hear it all the time. Well, I was waiting for the governor to say that about Flint last night. Well, if the people would just take care of business, they'd have more money in the city, we wouldn't have to switch to Flint River water. Well, if any of you are from that area, you know when I was in high school, we used to go to the Flint River and watch it burn. Literally, it would catch fire. Right? So when they said 2 years ago, we're going to switch to the Flint River water, anybody who's from there goes, I'm not drinking that. That'll never be okay. It's like a nuclear fallout zone. It'll be bad for 50,000 years, right? I mean, anyways. I'm in a chill. I'm angry. So, average new hire earnings. I'm sure you all know this as professional people, but when you take a new job, it doesn't matter what raise percentage they're going to give you. What really matters in your future is what you hire on at. Do you understand? So, bargain less of a raise percentage every year in a higher starting salary. Because that's how salary depression happens from time to time. People that started 10 years ago with a lower salary, they're 2 or 3 or 4% or whatever you get, doesn't catch them up to people that are being hired in now. Right? So you end up with people with no experience making more money than people that have carried the load for the last 10 years. So if that's important, look at the disparity gap between black and white. This is a local employment dynamics, 2013. Average starting salary. Blacks lag behind whites on average $600 a month. This is compared like jobs. So this isn't comparing house sweepers at the hotel to CEOs. This is like kinds of jobs. and Latinos fall behind $450 a month. Now, if you calculate that $600 a month out, you start to see that dip in median income, that gap in median income. And I always get asked, how do they do this with all the laws on the books? You know how they do this, right? Even in Grand Valley, when I was hiring, we've got more inclusion committees than you can imagine, and that's really great. But the bottom line is, they just send me the candidates. I get to pick the one that gets the job. So that all goes away, and if I'm not enlightened, then I'm going to end up doing what we all do. Part of this is natural. Picking people that make me feel comfortable. Either racially, by gender, by sexual orientation, I'm going to pick people around me that I want around. Unless one is enlightened. And that comes and goes, because this stuff is pretty baked in. We'll get to that. Poverty rate by geography. The numbers are still Islamic. Now there's no parentheses on here, so the rate gap is higher. In the case of poverty rate, that's not a good thing. We want the rate gap to be lower. So Grand Rapids, our poverty rate comparing black and white and Latino white is significantly greater, almost 25%. Significantly greater than it is across the state of Michigan. Percent of kids living in families with income below the poverty rate. Now let me stop for just a second. I always get asked or told or lectured at, why did we pick out race? Why did the Kellogg Foundation, why do some of us pick out race and ethnicity as the difference to focus on? Well, we've got gender differences, we've got all kinds of discrimination around sexual orientation, on and on and on. Because if you run all the numbers and you compare them across the board, the biggest gap, races and ethnicity, skin color should be more like it in this day and age, is the difference that makes a difference. And to show that, when it says Southeast Grand Rapids there, some of this data, I was able to break it down enough where I could go and find the census tracts that are the most poor, the poorest, economically poorest area of the city that have white folks living there and people of color. So what we're going to do is we show that in those areas, the income distribution between white and black and Latino is pretty close to being even, okay, in those areas. So it serves as sort of a nice little control group to say, does race still make a difference when we go to a neighborhood where everybody's incomes are within the standard deviation, right, within the range? So when you see Southeast Grand Rapids, it's actually 17 census tracts in Southeast Grand Rapids and a few in the near west. So that's a good thing to call it. So look at here. Percent of kids living below the poverty line. Even when we factor in income, people of color still lag behind significantly. Now you can see that it's quite a bit lower than the city of Grand Rapids across the board. So that shows where the region income difference made a difference. But even when incomes are about the same, African Americans still have almost 18% higher number of families and children living in poverty. Any questions about that? The reports we read in Grand Rapids go with median income, home ownership, right, and education. Those are the big things. And there's another stat that they use that I can't find. I don't know where they invented it. And that is time driving commuting to work. But I don't know where they got that number.
Yes, sir. These statistics and research take into account single-parent families and two-parent families?
Yeah, it's everybody. It's everybody. Home ownership. This is another big one, right? What's the American dream? Of course, the millennials are telling me you guys are going to change that. Then I hear the next week that you're not. Everybody's trying to buy a house. Then I hear the next week that you are, because you don't really care. You don't want to be nailed down. You want to be free to wear mismatched clothes and talk about the qualities of your beard. I was sitting with somebody that they took us to, you know what I'm talking about, to, what's the hipster? Now, I do this completely tongue-in-cheek, because I was the hipster of my era. We just hipstered about different things at that time.
You just took the R off the end.
And added a Y, or an I-E, right. And they were tasting their beer and talking about the bouquet of hops and all this other stuff. And I'm sitting there thinking, if I could get founders to put a keg of Schlitz under one of their taps, I'd love to hear if they sit there and go, oh, this is just a wonderful keg. It's Schlitz. That would be a great experiment. I lose friends, but it would be a great experiment. Home ownership. All right, I got to explain it. Of all the people who are householders, now remember this, householders are people who have a house rented or owned in their name. You follow me? That's householders. Everybody who's had a house, this all comes from the census here. The percentage of white folks who are householders in Grand Rapids who own that house is about 65%. Okay? The percentage of African Americans who are in a house or an apartment who own their property is 36.5%, and Latinos is 44.5%. So there's a big gap in home ownership within race. This is, if we take all of the householders in Grand Rapids, not within race, so we count up everybody across the board who has a house, a lease, something in their name, of all of those homes, 44% of the percentage then that are then owned, 45% are owned by whites, African Americans are 7%, and Latinos are 4.5%, about 5%. So when we take it across the board, home ownership goes down. This is a percentage of all people who own homes. Now forget the householder word. Of all the homes that are owned, okay? Look at the disparity gap between black and white and Latino. Now there's a lot of factors that go into this. But if we're gonna use median income, which we just saw a few minutes ago, right? Average starting salary, percents in poverty, and compare that to our homeowner's rates, you can see that if you go back and find that report from a couple of years ago, that's the number that was presented. Follow me? Disaggregated data. Why did it stay close to that number? Because simple statistics. What do we know about averages, means? What destroys an average?
Outliers,
right? Things that pull it one way. But if one group is bigger, completely bigger in size than everybody else, and they score in a certain range, and the smaller group score in a smaller range, you're going to end up closer to the bigger group, and that becomes your picture. That's why we have to ask the question for them. Now it's going to get fun. This comes into some of your economics, where our disparities are huge. Right? Huge. But you guys don't control that. So let's talk about education. Now what I've done here is I'm going to compare third grade math and third grade reading proficiency year to year. Right? So when this is a third grade number from the MEAT scores, when this is a third grade number and I now go to fourth grade, it's not a new group of fourth graders, it's actually the same group that were in third grade the year before. Right? You follow me? Try to make some kind of a comparison. So look at the math differential between African American and white and Latino and white. Down here, on math scores. And you can see it over here, it's pretty. And it compared to the rest of the state, we're outlandish. There's four. Same group. Let's go back. 25 and 23, almost 30 and 24. So in math, between third and fourth grade, Our kids of color, particularly, are losing reference. Right. Well, that's math, you say? through the region. Now, what is the rule here? We've, all of the funders, the state, everybody, we're putting all of our energy and dollars, huge dollars, into third grade reading scores, right? Everybody wants to get third grade reading scores up, which is great. Because as I understand it, I'm not an educator, or that kind of educator, but as I understand it, until third grade, kids are learning to read, and starting in fourth grade, kids have to learn read to learn, right? Big difference. And that's a huge shift. Well, research over the years has shown that we lose most of our African-American males. They effectively drop out of school in fourth grade, okay? It still makes sense that we put all of our energy into third grade. Well, for years, I didn't understand why that would be. Why would that be? Well, that reading, learning to read, reading to learn dichotomy is absolutely the secret sauce, okay? Right? There's a whole lot difference than hooked on phonics and knowing how to read it off the page than being able to integrate and think about it and summarize and all that stuff that we ask people to do in book reports and whatnot. So, I'm going to show you quite from our data why kids drop out of the program. Look at the reading gap disparity between black and white and Latino and white in third grade reading proficiency. We actually beat the state. African-American third graders are actually doing better than the rest of the state of Michigan at this point. Okay? I watched the bottom numbers when I said this next one is fourth grade reading. Let's go back. Look at the bottom numbers. The gap is 21.7 and 25.8. Watch the next one. Bottom line. Latinos actually do better in fourth grade. A point. Look what happened to the African-American disparity gap. From 21 to 30, almost 34%. Competency gap between third and fourth grade. If you're ever wondering why, when, if kids actually do start to drop out in the fourth grade, this shows same group of kids, I mean, on the whole, same school districts, same unit of analysis, 1 year after the other. It's the best we can do without going in and surveying each one of those kids to compare group to group and see if they're making progress. Because it'd be a different analysis if it was a different group of third graders and a different group of fourth graders. We could have just had a bad year. But this holds up across the board. Now it's funny because more energy lately, I mean the DeVos Foundation, Kellogg and others are pouring millions of dollars into the public schools around Coffee County, DeJ County, and Coffee County. Now, I happen to love the superintendent of the Grand Rapids Public Schools, and I think she's doing a remarkable job. And I had her as a grad student decades ago, and she was remarkable then, and she's an ally, and so this is no, I'm not reflecting badly on her. If I could, I'd like to go back, and I might pull these numbers from before she was the superintendent for the next presentation. But I don't want anybody to think I'm knocking her down, because I'm not. But let me tell you a story. I was doing a presentation like this in Minnesota a couple years ago, and there was a room about this full, and I tend to find three or four people's faces that sort of tell me if I'm sucking it up or if I'm doing okay. And yeah, you can sort of tell. And there was an African-American woman sitting way in the back. And during this 2.5 hour thing, she went, her facial expressions and body language went from interest to excitement to anger to depression to I think she was starting to drink by the end of the day. On. Didn't say a word the whole time. And I was literally worried when she finally raised her hand again. And I was presenting with a couple of my colleagues from Lansing. I was really worried that I was about, as the only white dude in the front of the room, that I was about to get harpooned, right? I mean, I'm sorry. And she raised her hand, and I said, ma'am, and she said, listen, this helps me a lot. I now feel better about myself. Okay, I'm a social worker, that's important to me. I've been working in the public schools for 25 years as a teacher. I work in an all-black district. We have done everything you can imagine in that district, from cultural competency to cultural. We stopped busing. We have programmed the school to be as culturally competent as we believe. All of the faculty and staff at the school, including leadership at the school building level, are professionals of color.
We have gone off the rails to make this right, and our numbers are still getting worse. Okay? And my response to her was, maybe it's not you. Maybe this is baked in. Following? 26 years ago, I mentioned this the last time I was here, Jonathan Kozol wrote a book called Children of the City Invincible. It's about where he did ethnographic studies of poor urban school districts across the country. And in 1991, when he published that book, his conclusion was the public school systems are failure by design. And I think we have to grapple with that as it relates to a lot of things. Now, does that mean you guys should just go, well, no matter what I do, things are going to get worse? No, of course not. Because part of our job is to make sure that the kids and the people in front of us have a better opportunity than the rest of the city, right? I mean, that's what you're paid to do. So we got to find ways to do this, but it's not just going to be on you, it's also going to be on everybody else. So look at this again. Between third and fourth grade reading, the numbers are staggering. This is third world country stuff. In fact, I spent most of the 90s in Albania and Armenia as a consultant, and those kids read at a higher level in sixth grade than ours did. And they didn't have, one country didn't have electricity and books. Speak in five languages. Right? So, if you're interested in this, I would get my hands on a report that came out in March, and it's by Education Trust Midwest. And it's online, Education Trust Midwest. And they compare progress in Michigan schools to some other states across the board. And what we learned by competency scores. Okay? Now, I got a big problem with test scores, and that could be part of what's baked in here, but we can't grapple with that right now. Everything's got to be on the table. What they learned was, city by city, African-Americans in Detroit get a statistically significant better education than they do in Grand Rapids. Now, I want that to wash over you for a minute. Kids in Flint get a better education by the numbers than kids in Grand Rapids. We've been dogging out Flint since I left there in the 1970s. So if we don't make this stuff public, I'm not trying to be the bearer of bad news, but if we don't make this stuff, if we don't know where we stand, we can't plan for where we're going to go. Simple as that. Simple as that. And y'all are welcome. Everybody's going to get this email to them, by the way. I'll email it to you, and you can email it to everybody if you want it. This is all public information. You can go find the data if you want. Make sure that they check it. I actually have people that do this, and I check them. So, any questions?
I have a comment.
Yes, go ahead.
I'm wondering if, maybe I was way off here, but what did you get the teachers?
Well, that's certainly going to be part of it. Well, I'd be questioning that, because even if you pay people in districts where they pay them really high, the gap still remains. You following? So we can. I agree. But they're still working within a system that's been doing this for years and years and years. So while I come from a family of teachers, okay, I would love to see them all get paid more. And I think public school teachers deserve to be paid, as do social workers. We deserve to be paid as high as anybody for the work that we have to do. Don't get me wrong. But I think, and I don't want to, I'm going to make this statement because you're saying what others are thinking. Part of the problem I think we do over the years is that in our politics, in our conversations, in our agencies, we do them when we're planning problems within programs, is we try to find the magic bullet that will fix it when it's a number of things that have to change, including a systems change that actually values teachers enough to pay them more.
That's a big thing.
Yeah, I agree. I agree. It is for me. You guys like to be paid. But I also know a lot of people that really have paid that can't find their way out of the barn. So, but I'm not saying that to make fun of it. I agree with you. I think the bigger point that I'm trying to make here is that we have learned over the years
that there's not one thing that makes any of this better. That it's a system reform of some sort. And that's got to start with the attitude of the people out in the world that y'all run into that don't know what you do, that they should just hand out welfare. Right? Oh, you're a social worker. You're stealing kids and hand out welfare. Am I right? I got family members in my family that are engineers here about 10, 12 years ago at a Christmas thing. They came up to me and said, so I understand you're a psychic. Handed me $20. This is my uncle. Handed me $20 and said, here, I'm sure there's not a lot of income in being a psychic, so here's $20 to help you out. Now I'll tell you what I was thinking, and then I'll tell you what I did. If I'm a psychic, you're about to get your rear end kicked. I can feel it. What I did was, thank you, and took the $20. I'll take that. Chronically absent kids. This is what everybody's working on right now. KSSN works on this. I think you all work on this. CFP, a lot of folks are working on chronic absenteeism. Boss Foundation thinks this is big. This is another one of those stats where I'm able to compare, because I have the records, Grand Rapids, to the economically similar area. And you can see even if we control for economics in that particular area, percentage of kids that are chronically absent from school still is higher than the city. Got something going on. Again, I also don't want you to hear this is just a blame the system deal. We've all got responsibilities this, and that includes the people whose kids aren't going to school. But instead of saying y'all aren't going to school, here's a few text messages to remind you that your kids aren't going to school, or an email that says you better get your kids butt in here. We need to figure out what it is that stopped people from wanting their kids to go to school, which was different than years ago. And I am public school educated. How many of you got public school education? Not that. Right? It's not just that. Because I actually marjorie. Percent of adults holding a bachelor's degree or higher by geography. You can see the numbers. Black compared to white, 23% less. Latino compared to white, 26% less. Now, there is a stat out there that I can't find, but I read it, so I'm comfortable telling it to you. But I can't find it. I looked all day yesterday again for it, and I'm going to find it. I'm going to go to Google if I have to. We found it in our Boys GR survey, and it matched up nationally, that African Americans with graduate degrees on average make the same as white folks with bachelor's degrees and below.
I don't know. There you go.
All right. And for Latinos, it's not quite as bad, but it is the same. I want you to hear that. Let that wash over you for just a minute. African Americans with graduate degrees make, on average, less than white folks with bachelor's degrees. Here's what the recession did to us. Okay? Harvard put out a study, and I have this one. Harvard put out a study that showed that of the jobs that were lost between 2006 and 2010 during the recession, of the 10 million jobs that were lost, people with bachelor's degrees and above actually gained jobs during the recession. Well, many of us actually were better off. Now, they didn't break this up by race, so that's why I don't use it. People with a bachelor's degree or above broke even during the recession, right, in all fields. People with high school diplomas or certificates with a bachelor's degree lost about 1 million jobs during that recession. By 2011, they had all come back. 8 million of the 10 million jobs were below high school diploma. Now, those jobs, as of 2011, only 1 million of them had come back. So what we have to think about, this is off my chart here, but what I think about, growing up in Flint at the time General Motors was bombing around and doing well, where the culture in my community was graduate from high school, take the summer off, party your rear end off in your summer, go to work in September, the job is waiting for you, buy your 30-year mortgage within a month of starting your job, because you're in for 30, you'll retire in 30, you'll retire a month before your house is paid off, right? And you'll be able to go travel and see the blue stickers on the back of your RV. Look out, Mom. You know the whole thing. I can say that because I'm one of them, okay?
Yeah, you're one of them. I'm going to get all that.
Yeah, I got that. Okay. In those days, and even through the 1980s, there was a path to the middle class for people without college. Okay? But this is the point here. In 1980, the median income of people with a high school diploma was $46,000 a year, adjusted to today's dollars. In 1980. In 2010, the median income of people with a high school diploma adjusted to today's dollars was $19,000 a year. Okay? So there are a lot of the folks you're working with, when we're having folks say, yeah, you know, y'all need to go to school, you need to not get arrested, you need to do well, you need to get your education, here's how you build up a resume, let me put you through a little job interview training so you can make $19,000 a year, you're never going to get to the middle class unless you're you discover something that, or you got a family who owns a construction without a certificate, an apprenticeship, or something else. That's where the path comes. To me, that's the fundamental thing that the recession left us. That was sort of the end of, starting with NAFTA, my boy Bill Clinton passed that, which is the one thing I'm really upset with him about, starting with NAFTA and ending up through the recession, and that is people without something, without above a high school diploma, statistically lost their opportunity to join the middle class. And then with jobs that aren't coming back. Even if General Motors packed up wherever they moved to and moved everything back to Flint and Grand Rapids and Lansing, the same factories making the same jobs, they would be employing only 10% of the workforce that they employed when they left because of robots. The reason they left Flint wasn't the union. That's the myth. It was that the factories were built in the 1910s, and they had a pole every 10 feet, and they couldn't put the robotics in there, and it was cheaper for them to build a new factory with today's technology than it was to retrofit these old brownfield factories that ruined the Flint River that ended up in their drinking water. So, it's a system-made, system-built-in. High school diploma, we're lagging behind. Right? This is what I want to tell you about. This is some stats, and I'll go over this. African Americans with a degree or certification are 4 times as likely to be above the poverty line compared to those without a degree or certification. That's everything from a heating and cooling certification to an associate's degree to a bachelor's degree and above. Right? So education does have economic value to African Americans. Whites, using the same criteria, it's 7 times more likely to be above the poverty line. And the stunning one for a lot of people is that bottom one. Latinos with a degree or certification are 11 times as likely to be above the poverty line with a degree or certification. So while it is good news, we can say this proves education is your secret. It's still not equal or even close to equity. You follow me? Any questions? Actually, I was pleased that it was that close. I thought the numbers would be bigger, but when you put population numbers on top of that, you start to extrapolate out a little bit, you can find out how we end up back at that median income number from the last section.
You have a question to the right?
Yes, ma'am.
Just
yell at me because I'm wondering. I'm not going
to yell. I'm trying to figure out how to drop this. I am not going to yell. My name is Michelle. And just recently I did some kind of rate regarding this versus whites in poor schools district. Mm-hmm. I did this with a young lady who is a first time college student. She's applying for college. And I was telling her in her area, how low of a percentage of people go to school with their, go to school to get a bachelor's degree. And that encouraged me to even help her with her essay as a first-time college student to get in, because she lives right there at Franklin and Lafayette, mm-hmm. one of the lowest poverty, poverty areas. I got down and we just went through that application, and when she saw this, it made her even more determined. And if more people were to do that, just to get out there and help, in regards to that, I feel that, a lot of people might be encouraged to go.
Thank you.
And we're just after high school, just to continue. I showed her those statistics.
What great.
It was amazing. It was amazing. I already did it before all of this class, but I'm just letting you know. If more people were to do that, get down and go in the inner city, her shotgun's down the street, we were writing an essay.
Listen, I have a horse farm, and I used to live in East Town for years, 10 years ago, I live on a horse farm, and I get more gunshots than one horse farm. Let's clear that up right now. Okay? I'm more scared of the meth faking rednecks than I am anywhere in this city. I'm serious. People all around me just. we're going to get to some of this in a minute. And that, what you're talking about a bit is determination, resilience, becoming an active agent on your own behalf. I'm going to avoid the word empowerment, because in social work that's turned into something that means like nothing anymore, or we go, I'm going to empower you to stand up and be free. Thank you for not yelling at me right in my finger when I did that. So we'll get to that in just a minute, but I think that's part of it, okay? Because we're not going to get to where we need to go without an actively engaged, demanding community. You see, a lot of what we get that. A lot of what we do is we think, what are we going to come up with to get these people what they need? When instead, I don't know about the rest of you, but when I need something, I'll scream it down until I get it. Do you know what I mean? Or I get something close. Right? And most of the people we work with aren't, that's not their way they've been created. So, let's move on. This data, let me be clear right now. This data that I'm about to show you from juvenile justice is not an indictment of the juvenile court. It's an indictment of the people who put them in. You understand what I'm saying? This is the juvenile court, detention, doesn't run out and snatch people up. But you know what I'm saying. This is about all the stuff we're hearing about law enforcement. If you want to see the pipeline from school to prison, this is it right here. Look at the numbers across the board. You compare blacks' detention rates to white detention rates in Kent County, and we're talking about enormous numbers, 262% higher. Now, I'll get to that. This is the one that should stun you. On the right are the population numbers of black and white in the city of Kent County, in that age group. 21,332 African American teenagers in their catchment area, and 48,000, almost 49,000 white kids. More black kids end up in detention than white kids by number. Not percentage, that's raw number. When we start hearing some of the things I hear about, well, we just gotta work with the families, we gotta work with the parents, and blah, 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 blah. Fine. You can't tell me that there are more white kids that need to go to detention. Your numbers alone show that a significantly higher percentage of white kids in your CFP program are home-based, not out-of-home placed. When I was running my treatment centers at Project Rehab, we had a program for kids involved in crack cocaine that married on to another program that we had. It was just a grant. so we had to name it something else, right? Right? Same program. And all I got referred to me were black kids. We got them all in the same program. They were roommates with the white kids in the program, with the same kind of rap sheets and the same kind of histories. But because it was a program for that, they're the ones we got. That was 1990. Okay, this isn't new. And I'm not suggesting at all that every policeman or everybody who works in the justice system is sitting around thinking about how we can come down on people of color. This is the stuff we're going to get to that is so baked in to us in this room, we don't even know it's there. Some of the races of people call them implicit biases. I'm going even further than that. These are implicit biases that are buried, that even people of color hold because we're raised in this. With all of the intentional action that's going on, how does this continue? And there's per 1,000 residents, 16,000 juveniles per 1,000 in Kent County end up in detention, 86 per 1,000 black kids end up in detention. Again, I'm not blaming the juvenile. I know these people. They're good people over there. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I work out in Muskegon County, and a lot of times the options that you're given, for instance, most African-American parents may have kids that are like acting up in school or things. Mm-hmm. They might have some slight issues. Get low file and incorrigibility charges and bring them to the attention of the juvenile justice system versus just send them to counseling or a mentor or something like that. So it's even the track of what options are given to you.
Absolutely. Infant mortality, we're almost to the bottom here. Infant mortality. Let me tell you, this is an area where we've moved the needle in the last 2 or 3 years. It's the only time I've ever seen it. Strong beginnings have moved the needle. Infant mortality per 1,000, this is the rate per 1,000 births, and that is infants that die within the first year of life, right? And as you can see in Grand Rapids, black infant mortality is three times that of whites and almost twice that for Latinos. 2 years before this slide was made, that number was 16.7. In the last 2 years, this number has come down. There's two more babies per 1,000 born in Kent County, in Grand Rapids, living, black babies living, that didn't live 2 years ago. Okay? But you can see that even with that, and we have to celebrate that success, and they are. And they're doing all kinds, they've just expanded through another grant to work with Latina women and their infants. There's a whole course of treatment. But still, look at those numbers. So if you take this, this is a healthy birth weight. And again, there's another number where we control for income. So unhealthy birth weight is still good feeling to us and initiate breastfeeding. If we take from the bottom to the top, jump around a little bit. If we take more unhealthy birth rate, now let me say this. One of the things we thought was you would find a big gap in the percentage of people by race and ethnicity women who were involved in prenatal care. Right? That's the logic, right? If we're having this, there must not be any prenatal care reaching them. The numbers were across the board about 98% report being involved in prenatal care. So it's something between or in what we're doing in prenatal care and getting to the hospital and after the baby is born that's going on differently. There's a lot of cultural things we could probably talk about if we were going to focus on this. But we start here. We go to school and reading by third and fourth grade. We go to the context that these kids are living in, which is lower median incomes by half almost, little home ownership, high mobility because of landlords and rent and on and on and on, which I'm trying to find a stat for. So juvenile justice incarceration. And that racial equity, that disequity definition I started with, racial and ethnic identities at birth statistically helps determine your success in life, is absolutely true.
And we could go on and on. Any comments? Now you know why you have to start asking people for whom? Who does this stuff work for? My program, I had a program, one that they worked at, I had a program that our surveys over the course of 6 or 7 years showed that the parents thought we were successful 86% of the time. We never asked the question. This was 25, 30 years ago. We never asked the question. Is it the same for African-American kids as it is for white kids? We just went, right? But you know, we might not have been as good. And take it back as to how we did with African-American kids versus white kids, the numbers would have been staggeringly bad. I'll be honest about that. In that day, at that time, in those programs. And that's just my remembering fond face. Who? Okay, we got time. I don't, because the numbers aren't big enough to break them out like this. So I would end up with that amorphous category of people of color. Do you know what I mean? Which disaggregates that more. Do you see? We have to have a certain sample by it's not that there aren't 10,000 Native Americans in town that fill out the census. It's that they're not geographically in the area that we can use to break them up. So it's not just numbers, but then it's by geography. And this data only gets effective when the smaller the zone that you can talk about, the more, not only for program planning, but for just for understanding, the better it is. So hopefully at some point, we'll be able to figure that out.
Do you know some things that you do to help
this? Yeah, I'm going to get into that in a second. Anything else? Let me talk for a quick minute about what we've tried to do, and then we'll end up with where we need to be, both at the systems level and at the practice level. Diversity started in the late 80s, early 90s. I was on everybody's diversity committee when I first came here. Everybody was on everybody's diversity committee when I first came here. Think of your person of color, you always ended up on a diversity committee. Right? And the theory of diversity that still holds today. Everywhere I go today, people say, well, we're working on our diversity. And that's great. Diversity is fine. And you'll see it's a part of the puzzle. But it's not the end-all, be-all, solve-all problems that it was. It's also called multiculturalism. It spawned the healing racism movement that Grand Rapids and Kent County is especially known for, the Woodard Institutes and all those things that everybody's been through 6 or 7 times. And I'm not saying those are bad things, but that aimed at healing my own biases, right? The problem with those is, having been to those, having seen them, having run a few over the years, the problem with that is that we all get feeling good about each other in the room for 3 days, and then we gotta go home to family, friends, Fox News, and all of a sudden, you step into home and you go, but I'm loving my brothers and sisters. And they go, where did you come from? No, let me repeat. Listen to Trump. Okay? Hear it.
It's fabulous.
please. I'm just making fun. The problem with this is, let me give you an equation. Increasing diversity, which is good, okay, would be like us holding a dinner, and we invite and recruit a diverse group of people to come to the dinner, but I pick the menu. You follow me? That's diversity. I'm still in charge. So there's no pathway to change. The way this was presented to us, if you read the literature, I've been in this literature since the late 1980s. This started with companies like Xerox and the big sales companies that needed to be able to sell things in Asia, China, and Japan, and they're thinking that I might not be the best guy to go do that. So we need to start recruiting a diverse sales force to allow people to let us in the door. That's fine, okay? That's fine as a step. But over the years, it's become
sold as the answer. And I can tell you right now, depending upon who you are, where you are, how you've come up, and what your relationship is to the system, just because your color of your skin is different doesn't mean that you believe differently. Do you follow me? Because I was told by a leader of color in this community not too long ago, a leader of color in this community, who I've known for 50 years in other countries. Yes, I'm that old. Well, I'm like 45. I knew him in a previous life. Who told me, when I was about to take this data and put it on a website with tons more outcomes, so you just download the things and use them? We're still going to do that, by the way. I was told that that was a get, that was not to be allowed, that we don't need people running around talking about this racial diversity stuff. It just makes people mad. I don't fault the guy. Oh, I yell at him, but I don't fault the guy because he's doing what he's got to do and did what he has to do to get to his place in the system and save it, right? Because they're not hiring people like some of us or me to lead anything. We don't play in the system. No pathway to change, no access to power and influence. And then there's one other thing. This is spawned. Spawned is the wrong word. This has led to. Because all of our classes that are now cultural competence and social work until the early 1990s, middle 1990s, no, until the early 2000s, I haven't been there that long, until the early 2000s were called cultural diversity classes. If you went to Grand Valley years ago and took social work 600, before the year 2000 it was diversity. And then it became cultural competence because social work jumped on the cultural competence bandwagon. And this is what this is the next iteration. Well, if diversity's not working by itself, maybe we just all need to learn to be culturally competent. And I'm fine with that. I teach this stuff, but I'm rethinking it. Right? I'm rethinking it as a panacea. Going back to a book I wrote in 2000, I started rethinking it, and then I just bought in. And now I'm back to that again. Cultural competence is based on the premise that those of us, that people can overcome cultural differences in a brief time. Right? Social psychology tells us the hardest thing to do in human interaction is to form intimate, trusting relationships with people of different races and ethnicities and cultures. That's the hardest thing to do. Right? That's what therapy is. We've got, you guys, it's iffy at the moment, but if you work in a managed care situation, we've got 6-8 sessions to form a trusting relationship with somebody who we can't hardly even speak to when we first meet them. On top of that, it's delivered from an expert to client platform, right? You had your stuff together, you wouldn't be here, would you? That kind of position? It's practiced in a situation, therapy, counseling groups, that's either foreign or objectionable to many of the people we're trying to get all to. You know, the whole cultural piece about telling people your problems, outside the family. So now we got all this stacked against us, and trustworthiness has to be built in a short time in the context of their history, the lessons they've learned from their family, friends, kin, about us, about the system, about what's happening to your records, about telling people, about trusting any of us, and their own lived experience. What are their friends and other people telling? So, I'm not saying we shouldn't try to be culturally competent. What I'm saying is that I'm not sure how far any of us can get there. Any of us can get to that. Which might be why we're having trouble with some of these numbers. The bigger numbers, right? Now, if you mix diversity with cultural competence, we might be on our way, right? We might be on our way, but let's not forget. In my experience, some of the biggest cultural incompetence occurs amongst and between people who look the same. When I sit down with a white person or a white dude across from me, unconsciously, there's assumptions made that we speak the same language and we know what we're talking about. When in fact, if we stop listening to culture as race, gender, ethnicity. And that's it. If we start looking at culture as the differences between all of us, right, we might have a better shot. So I can be as incompetent with a white person as my client as a person of color, as an African-American, to be with another African-American client. Because there have become some assumptions in the relationship made that we all know what we're all talking about, and we all have the same lived experience. My guess is that my lived experience and yours, all of you, are different. Even if we grew up in a picture we can paint as being almost the same. I want you to know, we can talk about this as we go forward. I'm just starting to think this stuff through, so I don't have any answers yet. I actually made that slide at midnight last night because I've been thinking about it, and I thought I better stick that in there because I need something to say. Now, diversity must be paired with inclusion. This is language we just heard of, are starting to hear recently. But that could become another cliche like empowerment. And what I'm talking about, inclusion, isn't just what many people do. Is we're a diverse organization, we have to make our brochures and our outreach more inclusive. This is inside and outside the organization. One of the problems with diversity is it gives people access to power within the organization. Right? Are you setting policy, or do we just have a colorful team picture? I coined this little phrase. I say a coin because that makes me sound important. I made this phrase up at the bottom. Nobody, it's only coined if other people use it. I'm the only one who's using it, but I'll keep saying coin until somebody does. So if any of you decide to use this, just email me, then I can say what. Knowledge is not power. We've always been told knowledge is power. It is not power without a seat at the table. I know a lot of smart people standing on a corner nobody cares about, talking to themselves, right? And a seat at the table without power or influence is tokenism. Think about what we do on boards of directors. I worked in Project Rehab, it's not part of Cherry Street, for a long time. We would always put one black recovering person on our board, and the only time they would get asked to speak, half the time even invited to the meetings, was at the annual fundraising dinner. And they would stand up and tell how great their life was because of Project Rehab. That's tokenism. So inside, if we have a diverse workforce on the ground meeting the clients, but you don't get to set policy and practice, then we just have a diverse luncheon where somebody else is picking the menu. You follow me? That's how the system works. So if we could pay teachers $1,000, or no, $100,000 a year, but if they're working in a district, we're above them, policies and procedures, all the way to the state, who are dictating curriculum, are thinking this isn't a function of curriculum and power and inclusion, this is a function of this is Darwin, some people get it, some don't, and we'll just live with that, which used to be fine when there were ways to get manufacturing jobs and they could also make a living, right? Who didn't do well in school? Yes, so you had your hand.
I think the tokenism too plays out in the education, you know, hearing the lady in the back saying, helping with scripting, surveys, things like that. I mean, that's great, but yet if our youth are not getting a good education, then the likelihood for them to stay in college and be successful is, is they don't really have a seat at the table that may last. And so, you know, I think about those things, we're pushing education, but yet we're really setting up a lot of the minority youth to fail.
Absolutely.
So
system by failure by design.
Correct.
So, and you guys and us are on the front lines trying to reverse this course, and when it doesn't reverse, we go, look, it doesn't work. I'm sorry, I cut you off. Let me tell you how baked in some of this stuff is. I was on a national Kellogg Foundation evaluator panel, and we were going to survey the city of Grand Rapids and the city of parts of the city of Grand Rapids and Detroit. Well, here and there, there's a large Spanish-speaking population, Spanish only, right? They got down, got the survey done, never field tested it with anybody that was going to take it, so they're using all of our middle class and above academic language on these questions, right? It gets better. It gets better. We're sitting in a meeting, and the person that worked with me, I didn't catch it. This is all baked in. My Liz Delaney, who worked with me at the time, said, so if we're going to send mail this out, how are people who can't read English going to get it? And this was the answer. National, culturally competent, racial equity involved evaluator. The answer was, we'll put a card in the envelope that says if you need a copy of this in Spanish, call us. It gets better yet. The card was going to be in English. Okay? I swear. And we all sat there and went, no, we all, a couple of us sat there and went, okay, let me get this straight. Right?
And even with the going even deeper into the neighborhoods and the segregation of the neighborhoods, it's like, you know, I live in Elder Heights area, and it's like, you live in that area, predominantly my neighborhood goes to private schools,
right.
There is no inclusion because you're living right. In the neighborhood, yet you're not participating in the school district,
right.
And it's just like this cycle that goes on.
Absolutely.
Also, as far as the tokenism, as far as looking like I'm doing something in the community, yet I'm
absolutely.
Not, I'm completely still segregated.
So we have to think about our boards, too. I know for big grant projects, you have to have clients and parents and all these people show up on the board. We have to make sure, are we actually getting people on the board and giving them the same leeway to talk about what needs to happen the way we give somebody with a lot of degrees, even though they might not say it as gracefully as some of us do, although if you're around me enough, you know I don't speak graceful once all the time. I get wound up and go somewhere else sometimes, but the point is that we have to learn not only at that level, it starts at that level. You're wondering why things don't work with some of your clients. We're in that expert client situation. What are we doing to encourage them to demand a certain type of care and a certain type of treatment? Did you follow me? We treat clients, the people we work with, aren't like you or I. It should be like this. If I take my car to my truck to a mechanic today, and I tell him I want my tires fixed, replaced, and he says, but your carburetor's belching smoke, I will go, so what? Fix my tires. And if you don't fix my tires, I'm going to take it to the next mechanic down the street. Shouldn't our clients have that same right? How many of you do that with your own doctors? It's a big problem, right? Medical doctor. How many people we know with a lot of education? White coat, this is a... What's that study from the 60s? They did a movie on No, not that one. Where the dying guy got to electrocute all the people and half, 70% of them killed people. You know what I mean? Because the white coat and the authority thing. I teach research and I can't remember this. Milgram, thank you. The Milgram study. It's playing out. The Milgram study. And they found out that women, men, everybody killed everybody on the other side, as long as there was somebody with a white coat ordering them to do it. I don't know about you, but if I'm going to a counselor and I don't like the way he or she sounds, or a doctor, or a mechanic, or a carpenter, or a garbage collector in my house, if I don't like the way they put my garbage can back on the side of my road, I'm switching. You know what I mean? How many of our clients have that ethic? It's been beaten out. So, we have to add diversity to inclusion. Yes, ma'am.
When I go to these things and hear people talk, I keep thinking of something that I've been participating in, but also ideally could be a vision of things where we get together, not just living in the same community, which is also can be very powerful, but participating in joint decision-making opportunities that aren't based on hierarchy, like community associations, cooperatives. There's a big to-do about that, and I've grown up in a cooperative decision-making process. And then also, with a lot of the peacemaking, violence that happens in the communities, if we had an integrated peacemaking teams that were set up in communities that, you know, we could identify each other as but are diverse. I mean, there's some precedence for that, but
inclusion. No, you're right. Inclusion. The point is that inclusion at all levels.
Yeah.
People have told me. People, and I have been one of them, characterizes the relationship between many of our at-risk neighborhoods, the people that live in them, this is all the people, and the system, our helping systems, the police departments, systems of economics and jobs and whatnot, have characterized Grand Rapids, and it is different than other cities I've worked in, but have characterized these populations as living on a plantation. And that is that we give you what we think you need when we think you need it, and you need to thank us for it. And then feel guilty for needing it. Right? But that's not just Grand Rapids, but the communities we work with. seem especially more quiet here than they have when I worked in Flint, when I worked in Detroit. Two sort of similar places. So, diversity plus inclusion gets us to equity. Now, so we have to have diverse leadership from top to bottom that has access to policy making and decision making, that equal access, that has a chance to seat at the table, and has to learn, sometimes has to learn how to do. But let's go even further. Diversity plus inclusion, plus community engagement, plus opportunity networks. That's the Dr. John Powell thing. If any of you have got a chance to be up and hear Dr. Powell when he's come to town, he's sort of a national leader in the racial equity movement. Terrific dude. I got a chance to sit with him. I'm on the board at LinkUp, and I got a chance to sit with Powell and the two directors for 3 or 4 hours and run through some of this stuff with him. And I'll get to those in just a second. This has to come at all levels. This comes in your offices. How much are you really allowing your clients to help determine how they want to be treated and what they want to work on? Or how much are we checking off boxes and making sure our paperwork is in good shape? No offense, we all do it. Right? When we say clients are involved in our treatment plan, are they, or I think we just get them to sign it? Demonstrate involvement. When we talk to people who are different from us, even if they're white and poor, are we speaking to them in our language? Not just social work language, but middle class language. Are we laying out expectations that they know from their lived experience, even if it's not true, but if their perception from what they've heard from family, neighbors, friends, since they were born, right, and all around them, that they don't have the same shot that you're telling them they need to motivate themselves to do. Perception is reality. Are we dealing with perception, or are we just needing them to do it? In our offices, we can be able to create engaged, active people who should be able to say to you, I always liked the clients when we worked together back in the day. I used to love the clients that fought their way all the way through the program, not fist fight. Yelled and screamed and MF and this and that and the other thing. And everybody who worked, most everybody worked there, liked clients that sort of gave in and went along and showed up on time and didn't run away and didn't cause any troubles. That's compliant. Change is hard. The ones who are kicking and screaming are the ones who are reaching. The ones who are going, yes, sir, I'll be there on time, they figured out I can just fake my way through this and get done it. You guys let me out of here earlier. Right? It's harder work. But more interesting nights and days. A system analysis. If we wait, this comes from a guy that I read, some of you remember, Paulo Freire, sort of one of my theoretical godfathers. And basically what he says is, and this is what we typically do, we gotta wait for things to change before things change. Right? Our neighborhoods are screwed up, we're never gonna be able to solve drug problems until the policies and laws change, and then we'll be okay. The system will never do anything to threaten its hold on power, even if it suggests otherwise. The system runs the way it runs because somebody's benefiting from it. Right? Every great thing that's happening in this country, civil rights, isn't because the president and the Congress woke up one day and said, you know, I think we should do something good for people. It started from right here and went that way, and then we made them have to change. How does that start? That doesn't start with you yelling at your executive director, Mike. But that might start with you cultivating a different attitude amongst the people you work with. That says, this is your life. You have the right to yell and scream. Right? You have the right to yell and scream if you're not getting what you need. If you don't tell me you're not getting what you need, I'm not a psychic, although my uncle didn't say. Here's my book. I want you to think about it. Generally, when Congress, presidents, agency executives, boards, government entities change policy, it's to try to keep us quiet for the next 10 years until we figure out that and do what it is. area that we can begin thinking about is Powell's targeted universalism. This takes on, this has been talked about like it's communism around town. But let me explain this to you. It's really simple. And you can do it at the funding level, you can do it at the national and state level, and you can do it in your work, right? Targeted universalism basically says is that we identify universal goals. So there's three containers. Pick any goal, reading scores. That's why I jumped out of it. We want everybody's reading score to go up, right? But look at the gaps. Historically, what we do at the funding level and at our treatment level in our agencies is we change something and we give the same amount to everybody. Right? And wonder why the disparities have remained. Targeted universalism says, well, we still put our efforts into everybody. We can take away this equality of everybody gets the same amount stuff. Is it going to help us get where we want to go? So we'll give some to the group that's almost there, but we're going to give more to the ones that need it. And you've heard that. Mm-hmm. Whenever we talk about school funding, somebody wants to raise school funding or raise raise student rates for some urban districts, and all the rich suburban districts start screaming, you're going to have to take away from me to get there. Let me tell you how we nullify this. Think of Black Lives Matter for just a minute. Remember when that sort of burst onto the scene a few months ago, and it really started to get attention around Ferguson and some of these places, and then when those two women sort of kicked Bernie Sanders off the stage a few months ago and took over his rally, and all of a sudden Black Lives Matter, and they're picking up steam, right? This might be the first real civil rights kind of movement that people are getting involved in since the civil rights kind of movement. It's exciting. It's ground up. And then what happens? Somebody comes out and says, yeah, well, Black Lives might matter, but the truth is, what was that? Say it out loud.
All lives matter.
So why should we put more emphasis on them when all lives matter too? That's how we nullify them. And as that picks up steam and goes on, we end up having, I've got people that are big targeted universalism believers who are now running around saying, well, I know all lives matter, but I don't even feel we should have to justify that. All lives do matter. The ones on the left have mattered a lot more than the ones in the center and the ones on the right for 400 years. The world is not a zero-sum game. You guys know what that is, right? That if I give 10 to you, that means there's none for me. It's not a zero-sum game. There's enough to go around. Remember this, budgets. Budgets are an expression of value. Just remember that the next time. They're always an expression of values. So when somebody at any level comes and says, we don't have the budget for that extra tutoring, they do, they just don't value the extra tutoring over something else. Right? That's where we begin to fight. Inclusion. So this has got to be part of it. How do we do this in our practice? Start spending a lot more time, effort, energy, figuring out with the people you're working with. Put our program energies into the populations that your stats say aren't doing very well. Everybody, remember for whom? This is the answer to that. Where do we put our energies? I'm not going to stop working with the white kids at our home, but you know what? Maybe we need to. Expression of values, move some budget and some resources over to these other categories where we're not making it very well. And your data is pretty good, and the people that did it broke it out, but you've still got that, and I'm sure it's sample size issue, you've still got sort of most of your data points are that amorphous people of color. Right? So there's and that's usually a data point thing, which is better than nothing. But and then engage community. until neighbors, citizens, families, oppressed peoples stand up and are figuring out ways to use their lived experience to demand changes in their lives, none of this stuff is going to work and change those big numbers. You understand what I'm saying? Most of our parents, many of our parents, if we came home in elementary school with less than competent reading scores, not only would my head have gotten ripped off, but if it was a school system thing, they would have been right up there in the principal's office and the teacher's office saying, all right, let's go. And you start small. Most of the time we think about engaged communities, we think, well, that's what Link does. We have to get people all to show up here. And show up. No. This could be getting people, the people you work with, to make a decision on their own behalf. Right? That you don't have an opinion about it. And then complimenting for the decision. Isn't that what empowerment is? Empowerment is, I'm empowered because I make my own decision and I reap the benefits or suffer the consequences. Right? Nobody else's choices. All right. Well, they're influencing the next season. They're influencing a little bit. And then opportunity networks. This is from John Powell. This is important. Something else you should think about. 83% of all jobs are obtained by because people know people. Mm-hmm. Following? Most of us, we get into this professional circle. If you're in this job, most of you, as long as you're competent, will probably never have to blind apply for a job again in your careers. You'll apply, but you'll know you're either going to be in the final two, or you're going to get it because you're going to know and have talked to somebody who's helping carry your water. Or you know people that can put their names on your reference sheet, and they'll see it at the end and go, okay, we need to interview this person. Right? Because we know them. That's the whole reference point. Now, here's what I want to think about. Think about the populations y'all work with. Who are their opportunity networks that they're engaged with? Somebody who knows somebody over at Cascade Engineering who can get them a job. So we spend our time writing resumes, practicing job interviews, sending out job applications. And that doesn't work. Because they have not got vertical networks. Their networks are horizontal. Everybody in neighborhoods generally are in the same spot economically, professionally, as everybody else in most of these neighborhoods work. There's uncles and aunts and brothers. They don't know people that can put in a good word, drag them through to get that job. That's what agencies like CFP ought to be working on. How can we begin to build opportunity networks? How can we play that role until they can get to the point where they start making friends that can drag them along to the next job? I want to repeat, most of us will never apply for a blind job again. As we build our professional reputation, that's how people move. Haven't you ever wondered how some people get promoted? I know people that can't find their rear end with both hands without sunlight, okay? And they're in executive positions right now. And everybody around me goes, how does that happen? I work in a university. That's sort of standard operating procedure at universities, right? I mean, I love Grand Valley. I love you, Grand Valley, pay me. They got people running big budgets. They can't make balance their own checkbooks. They don't even like people. They're supervisor people. How does that happen? Golf and lunch and friendships and neighbors with the same people that make the decisions that get them through. That's how that happens. The employment world is not a meritocracy. Let's be clear. The employment world, like almost everything else in the world, is who you know. What access to that secret world do our clients have? Do you understand? That's a secret world to folks.
How come I tell you this? Because I'm about to deliver my punchline. I'm getting wound up. I was in a meeting about this the other day, and people said, yes, you're right. We have to begin working with the people who have fallen through the cracks. I want you to think of a different, that's a standard analogy, right? I want you to think of a different analogy. The people who have fallen through the cracks have actually been there before. They got to the floor to fall through, because if you fall through, you fall to somewhere else. Most of the people you work with, we work with, have never gotten to the floor to fall through the cracks. Right? They're in the basement. See, that's my line. You guys are supposed to go, yeah. You understand what I'm saying? It's a different analogy. And language matters. It's not just being cute. Language matters. This employment job thing, this might be how we have so many open positions. I just saw a thing the other day that there's something like 400 open carpenter's assistant positions around the county where you don't have to have any experience in carpentry. You just have to be able to pick up, carry, and not put your finger under the nail gun, right? While somebody else is doing all the work. And then you can learn the trade while you're there. You hear all that, where are all these people? They must not want to work. No. This opportunity network thing is a secret society if you've never been in it. Right? And we can say it all we want. So the issue has to be, how do we get folks that we work with, even if we have to be the one that drags them along and use our name to get them someplace until they can start to make their own friends. And then encourage people. This is networking at its best. It's why we all go to them stupid rubber chicken dinners. Right? I went to one yesterday. Yeah, I'm still paying for it. It was a diverse group. Served chicken, what was there? White chicken at buffet, red potatoes, green beans. And what they did for diversity is put a little hot sauce on it. This is where we can help. Much of the stuff that we talk about that we know that's built baked into us isn't baked into our clients. The language we use, the expectations we have, the futures we build, many of the things we're asking our clients to do are secret societies from the people we work with. They don't get it. They've never been exposed to it, or if they have been exposed to it, the voice that wins out is always their friends, relatives, families, others who've been jaded, who've been left out, blah, 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 and that wins. Remember, people they know will always be more important than us, no matter how long they know them. Right? How do we begin to expose our clients to those things? First, you got to figure it out. What are those things? I'm giving you a couple today. But how do we begin in our programming, not just in your office, but in our policies and our programming, begin to demystify these little secret societies that we all benefit from and don't even realize it. That all of us count on it for the future. Good reputation, know a lot of the right people, Grand Valley can shut down and I'm going to be employed. Right? Many of you, grants disappear, program goes away, those of you that have made the right friends, talked to the right people, you're going to get another job. And there won't be much of a gap. Those of you that got here and don't are going to end up out. Remember way back at the beginning, we talked about who does the hiring? Remember? We're all going to hire people we know. Or people whose references tell us we can know them. Right? So, diversity, yes. With inclusion, access to power in and out of the organization. Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
A lot of what you're saying is very powerful, and it's almost contradictory to the system that we work within.
It is, absolutely.
Because
a lot of what we know, I mean, a lot of what you're saying, we know at our core that those are the things that we need to do.
Yep.
But our jobs and our agencies are dependent on funding from systems and organizations.
Yep.
That go back to that quote you had on the first slide, that it, you know, so how do we do this in the context of the system that we're in?
Start small.
Yeah.
Start small. Here's what I do know for the most part. If you make some of these funding systems look good, they won't cut your funding just quickly. Start small. Don't change the whole thing at once. Start small. I'll send this to everybody. Take the elements of Opportunity Network. Start thinking small about how, instead of just focusing on good resumes, can we start building communities of references for people, right? Because the truth of the matter is, even a great resume isn't going to help you if you don't know someone, right? So you see what I'm saying? Start small. We don't have everything. What happens, I think sometimes when we talk about the systemic stuff, we do what I talked about a minute ago. So we sort of think, well, until the revolution occurs, we're all pretty much screwed. Right, right? I'm sorry. But we're all, you know what I'm saying? Well, the revolution's not, remember the system will let everybody, the threat's all in power until it has to. So we have to start with the people you work with and think about differently. I would take everything we do day to day with our clients and put it in the context of some of this and some other readings and think about how we might be missing that. I'll come to you, I did not forget you, just a second. From your stats, it showed the white kids at the end of the program's CAFA scores were down on average, I got it here, on average 27%. That's really good, by the way. Black kids got out 16%. So what I'm saying is, I don't know why that is. I'm not indicting your program. You understand what I'm saying? This came right out of your annual report that CRI did when I was still there. So it's absolutely right.
If you say so yourself.
Well, I approved it, so. So there's a few things you have to look at. We got to do our analysis. We don't just jump up and chase it. First of all, we got to figure out, is that a function of the actual CAFAS scoring system? Sort of like IQ tests and MEET tests? If it is there another way we can do this that reflects change effectively? Is it a function of what we're doing with this particular population that we're missing something somewhere? Do a deep dive into a sort of a random sample of those clients and interview everybody and figure it out, right? Somewhere in there, if they're getting the same thing, they're coming out different. That's not just statistical happenstance. If you treat it as statistical happenstance, then we're back to this. Right? We do the same thing for everybody, and the gap will never change. That's how you can use some of this information, right? It may just be a thing. It may mean nothing at all. But if we just assume it doesn't, or we just keep doing more of what we've been doing that got us to the disparity in the first place, then we're going to end up not changing anything. It takes a deep analysis, not just at the leadership level. It takes a deep analysis with the people, with you guys, who are doing the work. I've been in leadership. I'm not in the rooms and in the offices with people. Y'all are the ones that have to tell me what's going on as leaders. I'll just go with what I think should be going on. You see, that's how you can do this thing. Ma'am, I've been putting you off. It's not you, it's me.
That's okay. I like to talk and communicate because I know people are looking at me and think I'm a social worker, I'm a teacher. Actually, I'm a client.
A what now?
A real client.
Okay,
Jade Johnson, who is here, is my parent support partner.
Terrific.
I'm a single parent, okay, and I've been under the poverty line for probably most of my single parenting, which has been almost 23 years.
Okay.
I raised two girls by the education that I got with my parents. Of course, I went the wrong way, got involved with the wrong guy, and so I went from middle class down into poverty. Okay? And I know a lot of people haven't heard this, but I went to college, got my degree, thought I was going to have the world, you know, at my foot, but I had those problems and issues because I was a single mom trying to raise my girls and with the education that I got. And I also was a very heavy set woman, almost 400 pounds just a few years ago, okay? So I lost a lot of weight as well. The issues that I find out that, you know, my daughters, who I have one at Michigan State University going through grad school as a public health medicine, I have another one with a 3.7 GPA at East Kentwood High School. I'm telling you that it wasn't for the community, for the support of the community. This person here, I don't know what I would have done without the community. So I do appreciate some of the people who have taken their time and been diverse, like volunteers and services. I did everything to reach out for resources. Now that I'm older, of course, I turned another age about a week ago. My birthday was a week ago. I like to help out. I'm trying to get a new job. I'm sorry, I'm old. And I'm trying to get a new job in helping my community with resources. Do I know a lot of resources? Yes, I go right into the inner city and I help out people. I don't care what color they are. It could be black, white, Hispanic. I'm gonna let them know what was it those resources that helped me out in order for them to get that same statistic. I go out to dinner with them. I don't have the income, but I still get you a cup of coffee. I'll give you a dollar if you don't have it because I reach out to that. So when I was speaking for Feeding America, which was last year in June, I told those millionaires how the community helped me with my weight loss story, and they donated thousands and everything. I want to reach out to not only people, but to let them know that this struggling mother, I'm a survivor. And I want to let you know that, yeah, I listen to jazz, I listen to classical, I listen to classic rock. I don't care. I play board games at Scrabble with shooters. I'm just letting you know, I'm a different person, but I am a client. And I'll tell you, I'm letting you, everybody know that, you know, not just everybody has, you know, these bad issues. There are mothers out there trying to fight to get out of that situation. I am one of them. And I'll tell you one reason. I'm like my daughter who's at Michigan State University, and she is, you know, with all the things she's trying to get through with her schooling so she can help out those. She said, Mom, I want to work in the poverty areas because you were the one that inspired me. So I just want to let you know, there's another side of the story. I'm a client. But,
and I actually hate that word. I think part of this, I know this sounds philosophical, but thank you very much.
I just wanted to give that up. If
you go back to the cultural competence slide, I've been working on this for years. We, and I'm guilty of it. I got to wrap this up in a second, so this will be my sort of my almost final. We teach all of you, I was taught, that the relationship between them and the client is a one-up and a one-down sort of a relationship. We worry all about power and influence. Well, yeah, we do worry about you sleeping with them, but short of that, I mean, let's be straight, right? Short of that, this notion, that's just not the way to build active agents and engagement, where we have these labels that, by definition, people don't want to admit to. People you know, maybe you in this closed room, and maybe you do in your life, but very few people run around and tell people in the community. I love going to counseling. That's why most of us never find out what happens. Because people don't want to admit that they have to talk to people like us. And if they do admit it, they say, well, I got this friend, I was just talking to this friend. We have to find a way to build partnerships. You were talking about inclusive. We have to find a way to build partnerships with our clients. Not just during the hour they come, or the 2 hours they come, or to the events that they come, but we have to find ways to, and I know you see CFP does some of this stuff, but we have to do it in a more inclusive way. We have to do it at times and in places that people can actually be there and invest themselves in it. And everyone starts with only 2 people showing up, because most of the clients we work with have a long, jaded history of not trusting people like us. They shouldn't trust people like us. I worry about people that trust people like us given their history. I do. That has to develop. You understand? I'm not that. I worry about it. Over the 30 years I've been in this field, I worry about that. I expect them not to trust me. And I'm afraid we have other kinds of problems when they just walk in, tell me the whole thing, and act like they're ready to go. They should not do that. Right?
given what's happened to many of them, many of their families, and their neighbors. They should be skeptical, just like you should be skeptical when you go to the doctor. Right? They shouldn't be any different than us. And we give them labels and we call them resistance and not. We got to get to the day where oppositionally defined disorder isn't reserved primarily statistically for black boys who speak loudly. Right? It's not a diagnosis, it's the way they were brought up. Right? It's just the way it is. Because this sort of raised up loud too. Right? Every kid who's distracted because they might be hungry, we can't get them ADHD because they get home about on time. We have to build partnerships and find out what's behind some of this stuff instead of going the easy way. Now I know you guys believe this, and these are policies that come from other places, but we are the only ones that can inform about those. And we can't inform about those if people like you don't inform us about what worked for you and what didn't work for you. You follow me? That's inclusion. That's a seat at the table with access to influence. I've been trying to get to foundations for years, and they won't do it. That if anybody in the community wants to submit a grant application, they have to go out and actually prove evidence of focus groups and neighborhood face-to-face conversations with the area that they're trying to get a program started to prove that they actually need it. Mm. Right? That they actually have to take data from their neighborhood that they want to fund something in to forget the census data. Go to the actual people and say, yeah, we need this, and document that. We'll get further. I won't do it. It takes too much time. How can we ask the agency to spend money on something like that? Well, you're going to waste it if you keep giving winter coats to people in the middle of the summer. I can go on and on. And we can. Now, before I wrap up, I know at lunch, there's typically some discussion topics. But I've said that if you've got questions or things you want to talk about, I can answer them while we're eating lunch instead of having the table discussions if you want to. If you want to have more questions, if you want to have more conversation back and forth, I'm happy to do that. So we'll just play that by ear. Or we can just do what you do and I'll sit there and say you can't. If not, I'll go. Remember, diversity plus inclusion inside and out. Engage communities, building opportunity networks. That's the stuff that goes to your offices. You guys got to figure some of that stuff out, or it's another dude standing in front telling you what to do, which doesn't make you tell them what you need to do. Those are the areas, your own cultures in your organization. You got to start, if we don't as a group start doing this stuff, you're going to have some successes along the way, and there's going to be a few miracles, and we're going to hear from you. And that's going to be great. But those numbers aren't going to do nothing but get worse, because they've been like this for decades. Right? So, thank you very much.
Dr. Johnson, we'd like to thank you again very much for presenting to us today. This is on behalf of CSP, Community Family Partnership, and the COR Group. So thank you. Thank you all for being attentive and participating in the presentation. We're going to go over and right here and go over to the gym so we can have lunch and get an opportunity to do some networking. And if we can continue some of the dialogue, Mr. Johnson, if there are any burning questions or burning statements or something that you feel that I needed more of, some strategies, how to take this back to my shop where I am, my organization, please feel free to write those down. We can get them to Mr. Johnson. So what we'll do now is in here, please take all of your personal belongings because we will not be coming back to this building, but go over to the gym and don't forget to sign out for CEUs and then when we get started again with our discussion, sign back in. Thank you again.